Despite the lack of hops over recent months, SpaceX Starbase continues to be a hive of activity with preparations ongoing for both the upcoming orbital test flight of Booster 4 and Ship 20, and the future acceleration of launch cadence with follow-on vehicles. Most of the recent focus has been directed at the orbital launch site, specifically the tank farm and the Mechazilla additions to the launch tower. However, Ship 20 is keeping the suborbital pad occupied with an opening salvo of testing that began. For the orbital flight test, SpaceX is currently progressing towards a readiness target in November, which will still be subject to clearance from the paperwork side of approval. The recently published draft Programmatic Environmental Assessment from the FAA, calling for public comment ahead of Booster 4 and Ship 20's flight, highlighted the requirements that need approval for the historic first push to orbit for the world's most powerful rocket. For the first time, SpaceX has put the first orbital-class Starship, a prototype known as Ship 20, through a routine cryogenic proof test, filling the rocket with several hundred tons of liquid nitrogen to simulate its explosive propellant. While it's impossible to jump to conclusions before members of the public can return to the pad to take photos, or CEO Elon Musk takes to Twitter to discuss the results, Ship 20's first cryoproof appears to have been largely successful. Musk has confirmed that the test went well. Relative to the almost three dozen cryoproofs SpaceX has completed with more than a dozen other Starship, booster, and test tank prototypes over the last 2 years, though, Ship 20's first major test still has some oddities. Historically, every cryoproof of a full Starship prototype has been visually unique and virtually impossible to predict. Without any direct insight from SpaceX or Elon on the objectives, plan, or timeline of tests, the process of watching tests via unofficial webcams, of course, and attempting to interpret why certain things look the way they do, or what's going on at any given moment is a bit trying to interpret eroded hieroglyphics. At the most basic level, cryogenic tanking tests, whether with Starship, Super Heavy, or test tanks and liquid oxygen, methane propellant, or neutral liquid nitrogen, are fairly simple. The vehicle is attached to pad systems, powered on, and partially or fully loaded with cryogenic fluids. Once the desired test objectives are achieved or attempted, the vehicle is then detanked, drained of propellant or LN2. Thanks to the fact that they're incredibly cold, -160 to -200 degrees Celsius, -260 to -330 Fahrenheit, Starships are filled with quickly chilled thin steel tanks containing them. With no insulation to speak of, that supercooled steel then freezes water vapor out of the humid South Texas air, creating a layer of frost ice that generally follows the level of the cryogenic liquids in Starship's tanks. Throughout that process, those cryogenic liquids inevitably come into contact with ambient temperature, Starship tanks and plumbing, white-hot in comparison, and warm up, boiling off into gas as a result. A gaseous chemical is far less dense than its liquid form, meaning that the pressure inside Starship's fixed tanks can rapidly become unmanageable after even a small amount of boil-off. To maintain the correct tank pressures, Starship, like all other rockets, occasionally vents off the gas that forms. And thus, the two main methods of interpreting the hieroglyphics that are cryoproof tests, frost levels and venting. Compared to earlier prototypes, Starship S20's first cryoproof has been unusual. Most notably, SpaceX began loading the rocket with liquid nitrogen around 8 p.m. Central Daylight Saving Time. Its LOX bottom and CH4 top tanks were then slowly filled to around 30-50% of their full volume over the next hour. However, rather than detanking, SpaceX then partially drained the methane tank and filled the LOX tank further before leaving the LOX tank more or less fully filled for more than 2 hours, occasionally topping it off with fresh liquid nitrogen. Then, almost 4 hours after LN2 loading began, Starship performed several massive vents. Ordinarily, given the hours of testing prior, those vents would have assuredly been detanked vents, effectively depressurizing Starship's tanks as they're drained of fluid. However, those vents instead coincided with the rapid loading of one or several hundred more tons of LN2, seemingly topping off Starship S20 in the process. Around that point, it's possible that SpaceX began the pressure testing portion of Ship 20's cryoproof, mostly closing the rocket's vents and allowing the pressure to gradually increase, to flight levels and maybe even higher. Many, many months ago, when SpaceX was deep into cryoproofing, the first full-size Starship prototypes, Musk revealed an operating pressure goal of 6 bars, approximately 90 psi. Ships were eventually successfully tested above 8 bars, approximately 115 psi, giving Starship a healthy approximately 30% safety margin. As the first orbital-class Starship prototype, Ship 20 likely needs to hit those tank pressures more so than any ship before it to have a shot at surviving its orbital launch debut and orbital velocity re-entry attempt. Beyond the basics of cryoproofing, Starship S20 also marked a crucial step forward, on September 29-30, becoming the first ship to complete a cryoproof test with a full heat shield installed. While it's impossible to judge exactly how well S20's approximately 15,000 tile heat shield performed, views from public webcams showed no obvious signs of tiles shattering and falling off as Starship repeatedly cooled and warmed, contracting and expanding as a result. Additionally, still in contact with the air, the steel tank skin under a majority of Ship 20's tiles would have likely covered itself in a layer of frost and ice, but the heat shield appeared to handle that invisible change without issue. It's possible that dozens or hundreds of tiles bumped together and chipped or cracked in a manner too subtle to be visible on LabPadre or NASA spaceflight webcasts. But that can only be confirmed or denied when the road reopens, and local photographers can capture higher resolution views of Starship. For now, it appears that Ship 20's first cryoproof was highly successful, hopefully opening the door for Raptor installation and static fire testing in the near future. As is almost tradition by now, SpaceX CEO Elon Musk didn't take long to tweet about the results of Starship S20's first cryoproof, confirming that the proof was good. Now, SpaceX can move on to test Starship SN20's Raptor engines. The spacecraft prototype will be equipped with 6 engines, 3 of those are vacuum-optimized Raptors, which feature a larger nozzle specifically designed for propulsion in space. The Super Heavy Booster 4 will have 29 Raptor engines that are designed for atmospheric flight. Booster 4 will undergo an individual test campaign. The first is expected to be a series of proof tests similar to SN20, then static fire tests of the powerful engines. It will be the first time the company launches a rocket with 29 Raptor engines. The engines are new in the aerospace industry, designed and manufactured by SpaceX. Unlike traditional rocket engines that are fueled by rocket-grade kerosene, Raptor engines are fueled by liquid methane and liquid oxygen, also referred to as methalox. Each Raptor engine can generate around 185 tons of thrust. Musk previously said their goal is to increase thrust from approximately 185 tons to approximately 230 tons on future Raptor engine production. Super Heavy Rocket is set to become the world's most powerful launch vehicle once it's operational. You can watch SpaceX operations at the Starbase. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching and goodbye.